Welcome to the Checkpoint this week with me, Vivian Kamsimi. Today we are at Uganda's main gateway to the rest of the world, and this is the Entebbe International Airport. Beautiful as it is, the airport has been in the news for the wrong reasons lately, from corruption to extortion to nepotism, but most importantly, situations that can lead to human loss. And those are the birds that hit different airlines midway. To dissect this is the spokesperson of the Uganda Civil Aviation Authority, Mr. Vianney Luja. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure and honor for me to be here.
You instituted investigations into the extortion videos that were around social media. What have you found out?
First of all, this is not the first time that we are handling this matter. While we have started investigations based on the recent feedback, these investigations have not just started today. We have previously undertaken a number of investigations on cases that we have received, because we keep receiving feedback of that nature. And to show that we have not been seated, from the period 2020 to date, based on information that we had received from different passengers through the airport, we had taken action and actually punished 26 members of staff from the different agencies operating at the airport, including immigration, port health, handling agents, which include DAS and NAS. We also have a labor desk, and we have customs, security agencies, airlines themselves, and UCAA, among others. So that action that has been taken in the last 2 years, first, is a sign that we are not just waking up now, but this is an issue that we have been handling head on. But moving a little bit to probably the recent thing that you're talking about, the feedback we received from the public, we highly appreciate it. That feedback had some legitimate videos that helped us to get to the bottom of this. But there was also feedback that was not genuine. But based on the legitimate feedback, we were able to arrest 4 members of staff from different agencies, including some from airlines like Turkish Airlines and others from UCAA, among others. Those who were arrested the previous week, investigations commenced, the disciplinary processes started, and the interrogation is going on.
Okay, so from besides the disciplinary process taking place, is there anything new that you have found out from these investigations that you've been conducting that you would want the public to know?
Most importantly for the public are the measures that we have now put in place to ensure a better passenger experience, and those are many. One, we have issued...
So those measures were instituted after the extortion videos
came out
on social media?
Yes, those are the new measures we have put in place. Some of them had already been started on, but have been re-emphasized. A case in point, there is a measure that is now prohibiting usage of phones by staff from the different agencies operating at the airport who interface with passengers. That is not a new measure. We first issued this directive back in 2021, but it did not receive the necessary buy-in from the leadership of some of these agencies. But with these recent developments, we have re-emphasized this, and it is being implemented. It is already in place. It was implemented with immediate effect starting last week. And this is going to help. First of all, the phone distracts the person handling the passenger, but also some of these malpractices are coordinated using these private mobile phones. You may notice a few people have been saying, wondering that we have CCTV cameras at the airport, that how come we cannot see this? What they are not realizing is that most of the culprits engaged in this do not actually do it at the airport. They coordinate, and even some of that money that has been paid is paid away from the airport. So by the time the passenger comes, he has already gone through that. So the prohibition of phones is one good measure. Two, we have asked them to ensure that they have name tags clearly embroidered on their uniforms, all of them. And that too has already taken immediate effect, so that when you are interfacing with someone, you know that I am dealing with so and so. Three, we have harmonized operations. Previously, we had a number of desks, especially on departure as the passenger accesses the departure area. We had a labor desk that checks whether you have a clearance letter from Ministry of Gender. We had a COVID 19 Port Health Desk that checks whether you are fully vaccinated or not, if you have a PCR test among others. And then we had another one for yellow fever, just before you actually access the check-in counters. Now, we realized that we needed to harmonize these, so that we remove some of these desks, like labor desk, yellow fever desk, which have already been removed, so that the functions they have been handling can be handled by more efficiently by fewer people. For instance, the handling agents have a document verifier who verifies your documents before you go for check-in. Even immigration has certain roles that can be merged, for instance, with checking for the clearance letter from gender for the migrant workers.
Okay.
So removal of these so many checks is helping, because now the passenger interfaces with fewer people.
So besides the customers complaining or coming up with such extortion videos at the airports, how else is your system enabled to discover such malpractices at the airports?
We have feedback channels that we have previously been sharing with the public. A case in point is the email aviation@caa.co.ug. We have a WhatsApp number. We have a duty operations officer's number that is displayed. Even before this issue, it has been displayed within the terminal building. And we were expecting that in case anyone experiences a problem, they can call on that number. And we've been getting a lot of feedback through those channels. And we have been, the actions we've taken before have been taken based on that feedback that we get. But and the other issue that we have taken, which is very important, a step to curb this, we made a decision that once a passenger has gone through the entire departure process and gone past immigration, there will be no more offloading or calling back the passenger. In the industry language, we call it offloading, much as the person has not yet boarded the aircraft, but is in that boarding area waiting to board. That has been happening. Now we have put an end to that, and we are saying if it must happen for any reason whatsoever, it must happen with permission from Uganda Civil Aviation Authority, and there are only two people to give that permission. One is the Director Airports and Aviation Security, and the other is the General Manager of Entebbe International Airport.
So how did we get here? How did the airports become a scene of these kinds of extortions? Is it with the rise in traffic at the airports, because we know that post-COVID you have had more traffic at the airports. Is it something, because you talked about 2 years ago, that is within COVID timing?
No, this, first of all, the actions, the malpractices are undertaken by just a few people. They are just a few bad apples. It is important for the public to know that there are so many staff at Entebbe International Airport from the different agencies who are doing a really good job. But unfortunately, bad news travels faster than good news. When someone experiences a bad experience and shares it, it moves faster. But we have had very good experiences, so many of them shared. So it's a few bad apples that are giving the airport a bad name. It does not mean that that is the norm. Nevertheless, it's not necessarily attributed to the growth in traffic, much as traffic has grown.
Yes.
Yeah. It is just those few bad elements. The good thing is we are taking action on them to completely weed out. But this is not a unique problem to Entebbe. This challenge is experienced even at other airports in the world, in the region, and many others, but that is not an excuse for it to continue. We, as the management of the airport, we do not condone these acts. We are totally against them, and the actions we are taking are showing that we are not for them. However, one important step is for the public to know the requirements in advance, even before they come. Because when you know the expectations and you fulfill them, then it reduces the chances of being extorted.
So what are some of those requirements?
Basic requirements.
Yes,
one, you must have a valid passport. And by valid passport, I'm talking about before expiry, you need to have 6 months left on your passport. Two, you need to check whether the destination you are going to requires a visa or not. And if it does, secure the necessary visa. There are some destinations like in the region which don't require a visa. Three, secure an air ticket, which can be either printed in hard copy or it can be in soft copy online. Then you are expected to arrive at the airport in time. We recommend at least 3 hours prior to your flight's departure time, because most of the international airlines close their check-in counters 1 hour prior to the flight's departure time. So once you're at the airport in time and you have those basics, also be in touch with your airline before you even get to the airport to know the destination's requirements. For instance, some destinations require yellow fever cards. Countries like Tanzania, South Africa, China, among others, require yellow fever. So if the destination requires that, make sure you have that as well. Not only yellow fever, some destinations also require COVID-19 vaccination or tests. So if the destination does require that, make sure it is also fulfilled. There are other destinations which also require that you have a hotel booking, for instance, among others. So check those with the airline so that when you are here, you have everything and no one can actually take advantage of you because of small, small things. But when it comes to migrant workers, those going for employment in the Middle East, there are some added requirements. The Minister of Gender requires them to have a clearance letter from the ministry and also requires them to go through registered labor export companies for their own protection. Because you have seen some Ugandan ladies who have had problems in Dubai, Oman, and other countries. And also because of that, besides these basic requirements that I've mentioned, the officials at the airport, handlers, and immigration have a duty to ask a few more questions, especially where they realize a loophole.
And that's where the problem comes in.
Yes, but much as they are asking these questions, they are not, they're supposed to do it professionally.
They are
supposed to take advantage. But let me give an example of some of the things they ask and why. We have a vice called human trafficking. And many Ugandans have unfortunately been trafficked or fallen victim to human trafficking, ending up suffering in other countries. And there are some tricks that traffickers use. One, traffickers give their victims two tickets. They do not give you one return ticket. They give you a ticket from Entebbe to your destination one way and give you another ticket from your destination back to Entebbe. So when these staff who check verified documents see a thing like that, it is a red flag that there is a problem here. So they can go ahead and ask questions why you have two tickets and not one, so that they understand. Now, what these traffickers do, once this trafficked person uses the one-way ticket to the destination, as soon as they reach that destination, they cancel the other second ticket, which is bringing them back. And then you are at their mercy. Two, another tactic that traffickers use. We have seen cases where one person in a country sends invitation letters to 20 different Ugandans from Mbarara, Kamuli, Mbale, scattered all over the place. And when our people see that through the security system, they take interest. Normally, this is a trafficker. How can one person know 20 Ugandans from different places and these people don't know each other at all? So that also is another red flag that they sometimes look out for and ask pertinent questions. And where they have done this, they have saved lives of many Ugandans who are stopped from traveling because they're actually being stopped from traveling generally because most likely they are going to be trafficked. So that is the challenge we have, that even when staff have taken genuine steps to protect Ugandans, sometimes they have been misinterpreted for making them miss flights. The problem is where they go ahead to ask for money, and that one we are fighting it head on.
Yes.
But the measures that they are undertaking are noble and pertinent measures in some of these cases. Moving back to the feedback that has been shared.
But before we go back to the feedback,
yeah,
can we talk about the traffic flow? How has it been coming out of COVID? It must have been less during COVID periods. And then now, what has been happening?
We are seeing a tremendous improvement in passenger traffic in and out of Entebbe International Airport. In 2019, prior to the advent of the COVID-19 pandemic, the airport registered 1.8 million passengers the whole year. Then in 2020, you remember, passenger operations were suspended from March to October. We had very few passengers, a total of 565,000 passengers the whole year, because for most of that time, passenger operations were suspended. 2021, the figure slightly increased to 940,000 plus passengers. And in 2022, the numbers are getting back. We registered 1.57 million passengers in 2022. It is not yet comparable to the 2019 figure of 1.8, but you can see that we are almost about 90% there in terms of recovery. The same when it comes to cargo traffic. We are having an increase in cargo traffic. 2019, before COVID, The figure was 64,000 metric tons of cargo, exports and imports in and out of the airport. 2020, the figure reduced to 59,000 metric tons of cargo. And 2021, it went back up again to 64,000 metric tons of cargo. And 2022, we had 60,000 metric tons of cargo handled in and out of Entebbe International Airport.
So in short, we are returning to normalcy?
Yes, we are moving back to where we were, slowly. Passenger traffic, we are at around 90% level of recovery. We are optimistic that going forward, these numbers are going to get better and stabilize.
Okay, now off to the birds at the airport that strike plane engines midway or mid-air. You were quoted as saying Uganda is endowed with over 1,060 different species. Twice a year, Entebbe receives visiting species as it is migratory path of birds from Europe. That is you who was quoted saying that. What are you doing to ensure safety from these birds at the airport?
First of all, the challenge of birds is a global challenge across the globe. But for Uganda in particular, it is unique because Entebbe is a bird sanctuary since 1951, meaning that birds should not be killed, but we need to find a way of living with them. However, birds pose a challenge to aircraft.
Yes,
especially on landing.
The Turkish Airlines 606 with 281 passengers had to get delayed to their destination in Turkey. Because of a strike from the swallows.
Not only Turkish, even Uganda Airlines shortly after.
Yes.
So what we do, we have measures in place that we undertake prior to any landing or takeoff. We do what we call runway sweeps. We have several bird hazard control vehicles that runs across the runway 10 minutes before a landing or takeoff. We have foot patrollers who patrol the runway. They use various techniques, including pyrotechnics that you may have seen in photos that looks like a pistol, but has pyrotechnics, and it is used to shoot just to scare away the birds. And when they shoot, they are scared. We also use those pyrotechnics, including Butida, among others. But besides those methods,
including Butida,
for scaring away birds, but the modern one, of course, the pyrotechnics is the modern Butida. Yeah. Besides those methods for scaring away birds prior to a landing or takeoff, we also engage the communities in Entebbe, especially those near the airport. Communities like fishermen, because we have a lake water body, so the fishing habits normally attract birds because they come to eat those leftovers of fish and others. So we engage these communities and ensure that they clean the environment in which they operate. We also dealing with all the other bird attractants within the community. A case in point, the methods we use near the runway, the grass is kept at a certain level between 25 centimeters to 30 centimeters, and that is deliberate. So that grass is not low. Some people have in the past complained that it is high, but that is deliberate because when you cut it completely, birds, there are snails, a lot of snails that are in the grass, and birds are able to see these and want to come and eat some particular set of birds. So when we keep it at 25 to 30 centimeters, they cannot see those things that they feed on. And yet if you leave it beyond those centimeters, there are also another type of birds that are attracted to grass. So we at a certain level. So we ensure that we keep it at that level as a way of fighting birds. So the measures we have put in place have helped us over the years to reduce these incidents to the bare minimum. The incident that happened on Turkish Airlines that you referred to, it was hit by barn swallows. It actually hit 43 barn swallows after takeoff. And that is not to mean that our team on the ground did not do their job. They did their job. The aircraft actually hit those birds when it was already airborne. But even to address that, after the team does runway sweeps, they have to move away from the runway when the aircraft is departing or landing. So sometimes as they have moved away from the runway, they see some birds coming back in the air. So when that happens, the team informs air traffic control, and the air traffic control communicates to pilots. That is another additional layer of measure in dealing with this. Now, the burn swallow that affected Turkish Airlines apparently is the same bird species that affected Uganda Airlines a week after.
Yes.
We are seeing a change in pattern of bird movements. This burn swallow initially was not in Entebbe. It's a migratory bird from Europe, and they used in the past to come in two seasons, between March, April, May, and October to December. Then they go back.
Are they the ones that are expected to leave in August?
Not August, because their season is normally March, April, May. Yes, then they go away back to where they came from. Then they come back again in October to December. That was the previous pattern. But we are of late seeing a change in pattern, because you can see this incident that happened in January was actually involving a burn swallow, which is ordinarily not the kind of bird that we have at Entebbe during that time. So the change in bird patterns and movements is also another challenge that we are dealing with. Our team, headed by a zoologist, is engaging in a lot of research in this area and also looking at what other countries are doing so as to engage this challenge.
So, talking about research, there has been research that has done that has been done for you to drain the waterlogged land at the front of the airport building. Is that an option you'd want to explore?
Yes, that's one of the measures actually that is in place. When you look at the area, not only near the airport, but the area outside the airport, there are ponds outside the airport, and similar such vegetation. So we extend there and engage some of those measures in those areas. But it is a combination of measures.
No ultimate solution.
There is no ultimate solution. You need to use a combination of measures, including that, including the engagement of the community, for instance, those fishermen and their fishing habits. Even the community in Chigungu, the dust bins, we engage continually those communities, sensitize them on the dangers so that those dust bins are not kept in that manner, because all those are bird attractants. Mm. So the main issue, preventive, reduce on the bird attractants, and then complement that with the runway sweeps and those bird scare measures.
Okay, so you are in charge of the country's image at the main gateway here at the airport.
Yes.
What are you doing to ensure that that image is not tainted?
First of all, one of the things we are doing in that regard is training of staff of the different agencies in customer care. We expect that the different agencies operating at the airport train their staff. That is expected. But where we see gaps, we have been forced to come in, and we've done that in the past. But now we are looking at the frequency. We've been doing it in the past. But now, based on these developments and feedback, we have realized the need to enhance the frequency of that training of all the staff operating at Entebbe International Airport, especially in the area of customer service. We do it frequently, but also pay more attention now to the new staff that they bring in, they recruit, or redeploy from other areas to the airport, so that we orient them in how to operate, in how to interact with the people while in an airport environment, because it is totally different from when you're operating anywhere else in the country.
Okay. How far with the construction at the airport?
We have various projects going on for upgrade and expansion of Entebbe International Airport. We have the major project, which is financed externally by Exim Bank of China. And that project includes several sub-components. One of those, there was work on the runways, both runways. We have two runways. The main runway is runway 1735, and the secondary runway is runway 1230. Those runways were resurfaced and completed in 2020. They are already in use. That was completed. The other, we needed to put up a new cargo center. Based on the growing cargo traffic, we put up a new cargo center with capacity to handle 100,000 metric tons of cargo a year. And operations have already shifted from the old facility to the new cargo center. And people are operating from there. That was also completed. Part of that work also entailed expansion of the aircraft parking aprons, where aircraft park.
So in short, you have expansion of the airport, plus also accommodation or coming up with new buildings or units at the airport.
Yes, which includes different projects, some of which I've mentioned. The other one is that expansion of aircraft parking apron, which has also been done, and there is some which is ongoing. And having moved the cargo operations from the old facility to the new, we are in the place where cargo operations were, putting up a completely new terminal building that is connecting to the current terminal building. That work is ongoing. The purpose is to increase on the capacity, the aircraft terminal handling capacity a year. Besides that new terminal building that is being constructed, we also had another internally generated project, which is more visible to the public, where we expanded the departures area, and now the expansion of the arrivals area is ongoing. That's the remodification of the current terminal to expand. We have already opened up the departure area, part of which is being used by passengers. The arrivals area is still undergoing that expansion. And when this plus the new terminal are all completed, we shall have enhanced capacity to handle from 2 million passengers a year to about 3.5 million passengers a year.
Mr. Lujia, let's just have a short break. We will be right back.